small pride, our small novel that I hope we can publish eventually. It's called Soul Shakers. From the moment my shoes were searched for drugs at Narita International Airport, I was treated like some exotic oddity. They presented me with long-stemmed tiger lilies and said, "Kangai," to which I replied, "Domo, arigato." They said I evoked the spirit of the expatriate Josephine Baker. I said, at least you don't make me wear bananas. I was dubbed their Nubian princess bestowed with the gift of song and dance. So why did I feel like someone's wind-up toy, like a minstrel, like Michael Jackson, only not as rich or famous? It was the summer of 1984, and at 26, the New York Times called Jackson a musical phenomenon. Not that I was jealous, but it might have been a little diva envy, but still, it was perfect timing for a wannabe like me. Since I had sung my way out of my house, my block, and my whole neighborhood, with some weird alignment of the planet, I managed to sing myself all the way to Japan. Oseki Dry transformed me into the seductress I became on stage in Roppongi, Tokyo's answer to New York's East Village. Being a performer was all about having a good time, and in anyone's life, there can be only a few such moments. A moment when time stands still, as if you have journeyed from your own secret infinity and back in 1 second. When vision is at its most clearest and logic becomes passé. Since I was paid off the books in cold, hard yen, all bundled up in rubber bands, I reported no earnings, thus no taxes. My tour promoter, Akaki Al Pacino wannabe, insisted I visit his office an hour before my show. When I got there, he was meditating and sniffing blow. He said, "Do you know the movie Scarface?" I rolled my eyes and said, "No." "Ah, too bad. Do you eat mostly fried chicken?" I just sucked my teeth to that one. Okay, but do you know Michael Jackson? And is Whitney gay? Can you sing the words to I Will Survive? It's not that I mind a command performance, but hitting those high notes can make you dizzy sometimes. The trick to making them absolutely pitch perfect, though, is simple. All you gotta do is squeeze your butt. And when the tempo is on the money, and when the guitar and keyboard and drums are all in sync, performing live feels like the greatest sex you've ever had. Over too soon and leaving you wondering what happened. Still, I said to him, "You mean right now? You want me to sing here in your office, a cappella? I don't think so." Then I turned my back on him and walked out. But I was being followed. Followed by cartoon images of soulless, enslaved, colored folk. If they didn't find me in one place, they'd find me in another. I caught them staring at me from a window display of a department store and from a shelf in a hotel gift shop. Everywhere I looked, I spotted oversized posters, kitchen cots, and dashboard dolls of Mammy and Sambo, black caricatures. Figurines with those bugged-out eyes and grinning white, ashy lips against charcoal skin. They resembled those lawn jockeys, you know, the ones you find across the Mason-Dixon line or in the movies, like the one where Sidney Poitier slaps an old white man and gets away with it, was rhetorically asked, "Boy, don't you know there was a time I could have had you shot for that?" Well, not now. Imagine being followed by Aunt Jemima. Imagine her wide grin haunting you enough to make you want to stop ordering pancakes in public. Enough to make you want to holler, "So that's what you think about us." If I could have, I would have spent every dime I had on the entire lot, either to dispose of them or save them as evidence of a hate crime.